Leaders' questions. Call on Deputy Micheál Martin.
Thank you, Ciarán Corlin. Taoiseach, since we last spoke in the House, we've had the resignation of Minister Roisin Shortall and a very revealing interview on the Marion Finucane show at the weekend, in which she confirmed everything we have been saying in this House for the last number of months in relation to work progressing on primary care being blocked, very poor management of the health budget, insofar as she said that we're now facing the most appalling cuts because of his failure, the Minister O'Reilly's failure, to tackle these issues. And Taoiseach, you may recall 3 weeks ago I asked you, was the delegation of ministerial orders laid before the House in relation to Minister Shortall's functions, or then Minister Shortall's functions? You didn't seem to know whether they were or not, and you said you'd get back to me. But when I actually checked them, Taoiseach, they were laid before the House in September 2011. And what's most revealing about them, Taoiseach, they're about various things from medicinal products to the poison bill to a whole lot of other things, excluded completely any reference to primary care. So despite the fact that when you appointed Minister Shortall, at the time of the appointment of ministers, you said she would have special responsibility for primary care, here's the order. Not a mention of primary care. So Taoiseach, isn't that the time when you, Tánaiste Éamon and Gilmore and your cabinet colleagues ditched and isolated Minister Shortall? Because she wasn't given statutory delegation for primary care. And despite, as we know from Freedom of Information requests, despite she seeking it on a number of occasions, it fell on deaf ears. And I'd like to know, Taoiseach, who excluded, who took the decision to exclude primary care from her delegated statutory authority as minister? And Taoiseach, she did meet with you in the Tánaiste during the summer to try and resolve this issue. And the suggestion was that a summer holiday might sort it out. Now, Taoiseach, we know Minister Shortall had deep reservations about Minister O'Reilly's performance. And it went beyond the added primary care centres. It went to the core of the implementation of the programme for government itself. And in relation to the added primary care centres, Minister O'Reilly has changed his story time and time again. He misled the Dáil last week, Taoiseach, by claiming that Balbriggan and Swords lost out and were swept from high priority to low priority. Taoiseach, there was no prioritisation system in 2007, as Minister Shortall has confirmed, and others close to it.
Thank you.
Originally, Minister O'Reilly said he consulted with ministerial colleagues and officials, but we can't find a ministerial colleague to confirm that they were consulted. Minister Radcar, Burton, Quinn, Crichton, all saying they're not familiar with the details. So, Taoiseach, can you spell out the criteria? Can you actually confirm that you approved of Minister O'Reilly adding those 15 centres and the basis upon which he did it? And Taoiseach, I presume that you are facilitating that Minister O'Reilly will come before the House today and make a statement and answer questions in relation to this.
Thank you.
Given that he is doing so with the Fine Gael party, and I know Minister Alex White has been asked to find out the details relating to the criteria as well.
Thank you. Taoiseach.
When you asked me the question last week about the statutory instrument, I couldn't recall exactly the nature of the instrument or when it was laid before the Dáil, and promised to get back to you. You're aware that the statutory instrument and all statutory instruments refer to a legal base. There is no legal base to a Primary Care Act. So in terms of statutory instruments, they refer specifically to narrower confines, but primary care, no more than public transport or any other issue, covers a whole range of activities. The situation, I can confirm to you, Deputy Martin, is that issues that were raised in the past few days about the pharmaceutical industry and the cost of drugs, insurance claims, and the issue concerning consultants being re-rostered and the savings that will accrue, which will be very substantial over the next number of years, are all issues that have been the focus of pretty intense negotiations with conclusion and areas of these in the past period and more to come. In regard to the primary care centres, when I addressed this last week, I did say to you that these were in different sectors here. Somewhere leases were involved, somewhere where direct exchequer funding was involved, and somewhere the primary care centres would be provided under a PPP system. This is all part of a stimulus package brought forward by government of over $2.5 billion, covering the areas of transport and health and justice and education, together with the major development at Grange Gorman. All of that stimulus package was announced by the Minister for Public Expenditure and Reform, and obviously approved by government. You're aware from your own experience of the value of primary care centres and how fundamental they are to providing a proper health system, a health structure throughout the country. I visited a number of these myself, one in the town of a colleague beside you there, which is very efficient and very competent, and they provide a wonderful opportunity and level of service for people, and have the very beneficial consequence of not having numbers turn up to accident and emergency who don't actually need to go there. We need more primary care centres, and what has been announced by the Minister for Public Expenditure and Reform is but part of the requirements that we need here. There will be more to follow because more are required.
Thank you.
Questions I asked. I don't buy your answer in relation to the statutory order, but I asked you specifically, did you approve of the adding of the 15 centres? Because we're talking about public-private partnerships here, which, as I said last week, have a very strong commercial dimension to them, because they involve the state entering into a contract with individuals or a company or an entity. And therefore, there has to be a transparent and open process. It's equivalent almost to a tender situation. It's a commercial contract. So you can't just fudge this, and that's one of the big problems here since the outset of this issue. And the story keeps changing, Taoiseach, keeps changing all of the time. And you might answer, Taoiseach, you know, 15 were added. What 15 were displaced by the 15 that were added, given the list that Roisin Shortall had put together? And Taoiseach, the more I look at this saga from the outset, the more I'm reminded of a poem, Taoiseach, by Francis Duggan, "One lie leads to another, so happens to be true." And it goes like this, Taoiseach: when you tell one lie, it leads to another. So you tell two lies to cover each other. Then you tell three lies, and oh, brother, you're in trouble up to your ears.
Thank you, Dan.
Now, I would never apply that, Taoiseach, to the cabinet and so on. But that seems to be, Taoiseach, that seems to be where we are in relation to this saga.
Thank you.
Could I confirm, Taoiseach, that Minister Riley will come into the House, Taoiseach, and make a statement to the House? Is that the position?
Thank you.
There has been a request by the opposition. I'm not sure whether it has been acceded to or not, but I think, without question, given all the different versions we've had about this, and given that Fine Gael are having a meeting today to discuss it, and given that Alex White's been sent in by some of the Labour colleagues to find out why they were added, the least we can expect is Dáil Éireann to have an opportunity to get a clear, honest, truthful account of how the 15 sites were added.
Taoiseach.
Well, I'm not sure what shelf you withdrew the poet's lines from in your archives, but maybe before you produced it here, you might have reflected on the fact that, you know, people said on your side of the House, "I didn't know that the IMF were here, they're not here." That you said yourself, "This is the cheapest bailout in history," and that you said on many television screens around the world in your travels that there was no need for a bailout, that would be preposterous for Ireland. So, like, don't come in here and lecture us with the poet's words. The fact of the matter is, Deputy Martin, that in order to put together a proposal for primary care centres, be they where leases were involved, where direct exchequer funding is involved, or the PPP system, you need more than the number that you set out to do, because of the fact that you do not want to be subservient to vested interests. You do not want to be caught in a situation where, for instance, general practitioners would not buy into using the facility. So the proposal is to have 20 primary care centres under the PPP system. But if you say that's the only 20 we're going to do, anybody could say, "Well, I won't buy into that, therefore you don't get the results you need." So the Minister has outlined to the House already the reasons for expanding the criteria merely beyond deprivation, but also to provide for competition, to provide for dealing with potential vested interests, to deal with problems that arise for objections and site locations and so on. So I think you can agree, Deputy Martin, that primary care centres are a fundamental part of the changing of the structure of the delivery of health services. Well, I've seen them myself, they operate exceptionally well, and I do hope that the process that is now underway to bring to a conclusion the provision of these 20 primary care centres, and there's a great deal of development to go on before that actually becomes a reality, will provide that those centres of excellence and competence for people in the locations that become a reality out of the 35.
Thank you. Deputy Adams, thank you.